Though Boston is a majority minority city with many, it still has a reputation as a mostly white one. But over the last 25 years, the racial makeup of the region has been shifting dramatically. That's according to a report from the Boston Foundation, which found that between 1990 and 2017, every single city and town in the area saw growth in its non-white population. In that time, the report, called The Changing Faces of Greater Boston, found that the non-white population in Boston grew by more than 60%. But outside the city, the population of people of color is now 2.5 times bigger. And according to the research, more than 90% of the region's net population growth since 1990 has come from new immigrants. But that's not the only reason for the shift. The report cites gentrification and rising rents in some Boston neighborhoods, downtown, the South End, Mission Hill, JP, for example, as having pushed out their historically diverse population, in some cases moving to traditionally white communities like Malden, Randolph, or Brockton, which are now majority minority cities too. But as the region has changed, economic equality and racial representation haven't changed along with it. Joining me to discuss are former state rep Juana Matias, and good to meet you.
Pleasure
and
meeting
former
you.
Fitchburg Mayor Lisa Wong, nice to see you, who became the state's first Asian American woman mayor. She's now the town manager of Winchester and a senior fellow with the Governing Institute. It's good to see you, Lisa. Thanks
good
so much
here.
For being here. So I understand that immigration has caused people of color to grow in numbers, but the number of white people is declining. My understanding from this report is white people are dying faster than they're giving birth. Is that so?
That's right. We're seeing a declining birth rates, increased mortality rates, and not just specific to Massachusetts, but across this country. The Brookings Institute came out with a report. And so we're really depending on our immigrant population to ensure that there is economic vitality and that we continue to see surge in our population.
And by the way, the move is out of Boston because there are some Boston neighborhoods, for I learned from this report, JP, the South End, etc., where actually the white percentage of the white population is increasing. That speaks to this whole gentrification, move out to the burbs where I can better afford rent. Is that not so?
Absolutely. And one of the important things to note is that when you're looking at immigrants coming in, we're seeing them on both sides of the spectrum. So if you're looking at the Asian population, the Latino population, you're looking at some of the most highly educated immigrants coming in and also those that need the most services. So the story isn't a singular story.
Well, yeah, let's talk about the latter for a second. My guess is in this pathetically charged environment about immigration in this country, it's the latter that a lot of people are focusing on. Well, it's a great report. It means more burden. It means I have to pay more to support people who need additional services. What's the response to that?
So I think that's an unfortunate storyline. We're actually returning to what made this country the way it is right now. We're at 28% of the population is foreign-born, and if you look 100 years ago, it was, I think, closer to 35%. So in many ways, when we have that narrative, I think it's a very political one. It's not really the true one. And if we're looking at who is providing the jobs, the backbone of our communities, it's immigrants.
I mean, that is the key. You mentioned this before. This economic growth, which matters to everybody, regardless of politics, is being driven overwhelmingly by immigrants, is it not, in Boston and beyond?
Absolutely. And I think as a state, what we really need to be looking at is how are we giving opportunity and access to these immigrant populations, a quality education, job training? How are we ensuring that there is inclusive and diverse leadership in our nonprofit sector and our elected governing positions? And I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done.
I can answer the question of how we're doing it. We're not, is the answer
That's
to
right.
the question, which to me is the most important part of the report. Let me just add a couple of stats here from this Boston Foundation report. Here's representation lagging clearly behind population in Greater Boston. Non-white residents, 32% of the population, non-white CEOs and legislators, 14% of the population. I mean, how do we begin to bridge that divide? There still is an old boys network in this community that we've all, I mean, I'm one of the old boys, I guess, but I hope I'm not doing the wrong thing. How do we break through that?
I think that we need to employ different strategies. I think when it comes to our political institutions, our Democratic political parties, both the Republican and the Democratic Party, could do more in recruiting candidates and supporting candidates of color. I think the fact that we have a full-time legislature with incumbency and war chest make it very difficult for new candidates of color to think about running for office. I think when you look at the nonprofit sector, could we really be making sure that some of our governance boards have subcommittees that focus on diversity and inclusiveness, not just at the board level, but also looking at the overall organization.
But isn't there resistance? I remember reading a story recently that something as innocuous as, I hope I get this right, as a bill on Beacon Hill where you used to spend your time, mm-hmm. the merely would have required the reporting of women and people of color on boards of directors where it was opposed by some of the most important and powerful business groups, merely reporting, not even a mandate that there be changes. Is that cause for pessimism or no?
I don't think so. I do think that the issue is pervasive. So I got a lot of attention when I became mayor, but very little attention when I became town manager. There are over 300 town managers and administrators, and I'm probably the first Asian town manager. That's a pretty significant statistic, but not one that we talk about. So I think we've made progress in terms of having organizations supporting elected officials of color. I think what we're doing is we have this entire playing field. So the nonprofit sector, the boards, and even in municipal government that are not elected, these are the areas that we need to deepen our playing field because we have a ton of policymakers that are working in these areas that don't garner a lot of attention.
Well, also, speaking of garnering attention, that story in the Globe, which I'm sure you both read about, 1%, less than 1% of $664 million, I think, in city contracts going to women and minority-owned firms. And John Barros, who I respect, has an answer that to me is otherworldly. Chief of Economic Development for the city says the willingness to contract is there, the number of contractors is not. I mean, that's the story I've heard, and I'm sure you've heard your whole lives. We'd love to hire some black employees. Unfortunately, there aren't any that are qualified. I mean, can you still say this in 2019?
I would disagree. I think we need leaders that are intentional. I've seen in Lawrence, and I give a lot of credit to our mayor, how he's taking our police department and is making it as on the way to become a minority-majority police department. It's about people who see the value in diversity and who implement actions to make sure that we're being inclusive and diverse.
Well, that's a good example. Dan Rivera is his name for those who don't know. What's the single most important thing you think should happen in response to this report from people in positions of power in this greater Boston community?
So along the lines of what we talked about in terms of representation, there is a study that was done about low-income African-Americans and saying that if they have a teacher of color in third, fourth, and fifth grade, their chances of dropping out reduced by 39%. So we need people in the entire playing field. So we need to look at the way that we educate our teachers, how we attract people to actually want to be teachers, town managers. I think it's going to be pervasive, small businesses. So we need to see representative across the board, which means we need to look at the foundation.
Are you hopeful? I mean, this may be naive. When you see a report like this and you say in the starkest terms, immigrants are the future of this region. It's not on the periphery. It is at the core. These percentages are astronomical. Does that change? Does that crack open the minds of resistant souls, or does it not?
I would hope so. I mean, in my time at the State House, I was leading on immigrant-related initiatives, and there was this fear of tying oneself to these issues in legislation. And I think we really need to look at the fact that our state depends on immigrants in order for us to continue to see growth and vitality. And we need to leave that rhetoric aside and really look at the facts.
So I would frame it differently. I would say it's not our future. It's our past, present, and future. So people are looking at this as a big change. And certainly there's always change. But change is necessary to move the economy forward. But if you look at immigration, it's the bedrock. It's the past, the present, and the future of our country.
Lisa, it's great to see you again.
Thank you.
So much. Congratulations on the report. Juana, it's great to
Jim,
meet you.
Such
Thanks
a pleasure.
So